dear learners, I'm Christina Georgi and I welcome you to my session. Today we'll deal with American literature. What exactly in American literature? Yes indeed, The Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne. We'll discuss The Scarlet Letter in two parts. This is part one. So in this part, the major focus areas include an introduction to The Scarlet Letter, the life and works of Nathaniel Hawthorne, the Puritan background, the setting of the novel, the custom house that serves as an introduction to the novel, and finally a brief summary of The Scarlet Letter. Moving on to the introduction part, The Scarlet Letter by Nathaniel Hawthorne often secures an important place in most of the American literature syllabi across the universities. Do you know why? This is simply because The Scarlet Letter was one of the first mass-produced books in America. It was very popular when it first got published in the year 1850 and is still considered a classic 2 centuries later, even today. So The Scarlet Letter was Hawthorne's first and greatest success. The novel inspired numerous adaptations, mainly film and stage adaptations. Let's have a look at the life and works of Nathaniel Hawthorne. Hawthorne was an American novelist and short story writer. He was born in Salem, Massachusetts in the year 1804. His notable novels include The House of Seven Gables, a romance in 1851, and The Blithedale Romance in the year 1852. His notable short stories include Twice Told Tales in 1837 and Tanglewood Tales in 1853. Now let's have a look at the chief features of his writings. Most of his writings focus on history, morality, and religion. There is this constant use of moral metaphors with an anti-Puritan inspiration. What do you mean by the term Puritan? Who were the Puritans? Let's have a look at the Puritan background of the novel. The Puritans were the English Protestants in the 16th and 17th centuries who sought to purify the Church of England of the Roman Catholic practices. Puritans played a significant role in the English history as well. You must have studied that in your History of English Language and Literature textbooks. Moving on to the setting of the novel. The Scarlet Letter is set in the colonial period of American history. Soon after Columbus discovered America, many European nations started to colonize the land. With the arrival of the Pilgrims and Puritans in 1620s, the main settlement of Massachusetts began. The Puritans saw themselves as chosen by God to build a new Jerusalem in this virgin land. In this very task of reconstruction, the Puritans demanded total social cohesion and submission by the community to the dictates of the church. Now, let's have a look at the custom house and its importance in this novel. So at the onset of The Scarlet Letter, an unnamed narrator finds a scarlet letter and an old manuscript. The narrator tells us that he got the story of The Scarlet Letter from the documents he found in the old surveyor's office. The custom house serves as an introduction to the novel. It also provides a frame for the main narrative of the novel. It could also be considered as an effort from Hawthorne's part to persuade the readers to regard The Scarlet Letter as truth rather than fiction. Now let's have a look at the summary. So here is a very brief summary of the novel. The story takes place during the Puritan times in Massachusetts, where we meet Hester Prynne, a beautiful young lady. So she serves as the protagonist of this novel.
What do you mean by the term protagonist? It simply means the central character. So let me ask you, who's the protagonist of the Scarlet Letter? It's Hester Prynne, we could say that, yes. So she gives birth to a baby. But remember, this baby is of unknown parentage. Oh God, this is the Puritan era, and definitely she has to face consequences, and therefore she gets forced to stand on the scaffold for 3 long hours. And yes, you guessed it right, she is exposed to public humiliation as well, and she gets forced to wear the scarlet letter A, symbolic of adultery, for the rest of her life. But despite the efforts of every authority there, she refuses to name the child's father. Later, as Hester looks out over the crowd, she notices her long-lost husband. Who's that? It's Roger Chillingworth. We know that he is a doctor, but he hides his identity as Hester's husband. Do you know why? It's simply because he's totally disappointed with his wife's adulterous act, and he vows to find the man responsible for Hester's adulterous act. And for that matter, he chooses the new name. What's the new name? It's Roger Chillingworth. And he chooses his name to aid his new plan. He also visits Hester in prison. He tells her to conceal their relationship. That is, not to tell anybody that he is her husband. And he threatens her as well. That is, he says if at all she reveals this fact, he'll definitely kill the child's father. But the irony is that Chillingworth doesn't know who the real father is, and Hester still refuses to name the child's father as well. But we do know who the child's father is. Who's that? It's none other than Arthur Dimmesdale. So who is Arthur Dimmesdale? He is the minister of Hester's church, a very young and charismatic personality. So he also questions Hester, still she refuses to reveal the name in public. As time passes by, we meet Pearl. Who's Pearl? Pearl is none other than Hester's daughter. Okay, so after her release from the prison, Hester settles in a cottage with her daughter Pearl. She performs act of charity for the poor, but the church members are not very happy with Pearl, and they suggest that Pearl be taken away from her. And she goes to Dimmesdale and pleads to him, and it is only with the active intervention of Dimmesdale that Hester wins Pearl's custody. Later we see that Dimmesdale falls sick. It's mainly because of his guilt, it seems. But Chillingworth was very cunning, and being the physician, he gets in close contact with Dimmesdale, and he begins to suspect that Dimmesdale is Pearl's father. And to know the truth, he applies psychological pressure to the minister, and the minister gets tormented with guilt. Chillingworth also sees a symbol that represents the shame, that is Dimmesdale's shame, on his chest. It's not very clear what exactly the symbol is though. Yes, and later Dimmesdale goes to the scaffold and confesses his guilt. He declares that he is Pearl's father and later dies in Hester's arms. So what happens to Chillingworth? He also dies, but he leaves Pearl a substantial inheritance. So Pearl and Hester leave the place, and they also leave for a few years. But later Hester gets buried near the grave of Dimmesdale, and we see a letter A ingrained on their grave as well.
So that was The Scarlet Letter Part 1 in Simple Digestible Bits. We'll deal with The Scarlet Letter Part 2 in our upcoming video. So stay tuned and
let me know your opinions in the comment box. For more such useful topics, please do subscribe the channel. Thank you for watching.